If I had only known the last time would be the last time, I would have put off all the things I had to do. I would have stayed a little longer, held on a little tighter. Now what I'd give for one more day with you. Cause there's a wound here in my heart where something's missing, and they tell me that it's gonna heal with time. But I know you're in a place where all your wounds have been erased, and knowing yours are healed is healing mine. The only scars in heaven, it won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven are on the hands that hold you now. I know the road you walked was anything but easy. Picked up your share of scars along the way. Oh, but now you're standing in the sun. You fought your fight and your race is run. The pain is all a million miles away. The only scars in heaven, it won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing.
Y'all welcome to stand and worship this morning.
Our God, firm foundation, our rock, the only solid ground. The nations rise and fall. Kingdoms once strong, now shaken. We trust forever in your name, the name of Jesus.
Man, let's give a hand for the Lord this morning.
You may be seated. So last week, talking about the new year and New Year's resolutions, I kind of just brought up the idea, right, that if we want to change something in our lives so that we might be better followers of God, we have to trust in God for that change, because it's not something that we can do through our own power, right? But when we look at everything else that's going on in the world, and it was kind of fitting that this came up in our Sunday school class this morning, but the world isn't, you know, the best place, you know, all the time. There's There's all kinds of things that you can look at on the news or just around you in your own neighborhood, at your job, whatever it is, that can be negative, right, just as a result of the world being fallen. And so this morning, I wanted to read from Revelations chapter 21 to kind of keep that same concept going of things being made new, right? Because we are able to come and be better followers of God, or to be followers of God because he's made us new. And so I'm going to read Revelations 21, verses 1 through 4, or 1 through 5. It says, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away.' And he who was seated on the throne said, 'Behold, I am making all things new.'" Right? So as we go into this new year, remember to trust in God for changes in your own life, right? Don't rely on your own power, your own determination, your own will to make those changes. But then also just remember to be ultimately looking forward to the new earth, the new heavens, God making all things new when he comes again, because that's ultimately what we have our hope in, and that's where we can find our joy, and that gives us the strength to carry on living this life, you know, even if things around us aren't going as well as we would hope them to be. So with that, will you pray with me? God, we just thank you today for this great opportunity and this wonderful weather to come into your house to praise you for all the great things you've done, to fellowship with one another, God, as believers, as fellow brothers and sisters in Christ. And we just thank you for all the blessings you've given us this past year, and that you've already given us into this new year, God. And so we just continue to thank you for those things that you've done. We also just continue to ask that you be with us this year. Give us strength, give us wisdom, give us peace, give us joy, God. All these things that you promise us, we just continue to ask that you keep your promises, God, as we know you will, and that we trust in you for those things, so that we might look forward to eternity with you, and that we might look forward to you making all things new, God, and renewing us as well. I pray for Anthony and his message this morning, that you speak through him, give him the words that you want us to hear this morning, God, and let us not go home with empty minds or empty hearts, but work through him and into our lives, God. I pray for anyone in the church who's still struggling with any kind of injuries, illnesses, financial struggles, losses of loved ones, God, whatever the case is, we just continue to ask that you be with them, give them peace, give them healing, give them comfort, God, and work through us as well as the body of Christ in their lives, so that we might be representatives of you to them. All this I pray in your son's name. Amen.
Well, good morning. And if you're a visitor with us this morning, we are super happy to have you. We do have a connection card in the pew in front of you, just a white slip of paper like that. We'd love for you to fill that out. It's also got some, if you have any questions about any of the ministries or events we have going on here at the church, you can, you know, put that on there. And then when we pass the offering plate later in the service, if you just put your connection card in there, we can get back to you and get you whatever information you need. Or if you're watching us online, or if you want to go online yourselves, you could do that on our church website. We have the information up there. Or you could find it on our Facebook or direct message us on our Facebook page as well. So for the next few moments, I'd like to invite everyone to stand up and greet each other in the name of the Lord.
I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? still will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall, will I sing hallelujah, will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine, I can only imagine. Day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine, yeah. I can only imagine.
Please make your way back to your seat. It's so good to see everybody here this morning. May I say to you, church family, happy 150th. Amen. We made it so far. Not technically, but it's the year, right? Amen. Praise God for that. Well, if you haven't come down yet, children, would you please do so? Jacob, you're looking especially nice this morning. Let me ask you something. Did you get a haircut?
No, I got all of them cut.
All right. That's my joke. What's not a joke is your lesson today with St. Phyllis, children. You will be learning about the men that came to worship, actually, that came to worship Jesus and continued to do so. So you are dismissed.
All right. Let's stand as we continue to worship this morning. And let's pray. Father God, I just thank you for this time. Thank you for this opportunity to worship with our brothers and sisters here today, God. Just as we continue to sing these songs to you, I pray that the words just penetrate our heart, God. We would understand what we're singing. They wouldn't just be empty words, and it wouldn't be, you know, just an empty melody that we're lifting up to you, Lord. But we'd be communicating the truth. We'd be communicating our thankfulness to you. We'd be glorifying you in everything that we do and say. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
You came for criminals and every Pharisee. You came for hypocrites, even one like me. You carry sin and shame, the guilt of every man, the weight of all I've done, nailed into your hand. Bled for me. Oh, your blood in crimson streams. Oh, your death is hell's defeat. All across meant to kill.
Let's sing that chorus one more time.
Darkness now is ended. In the kingdom of light, in the kingdom of light, forever under your dominion. You're the king of my life, you're the king of my life. Hear an anthem of
Jesus, you reign above it all. Send the darkness running out of an empty grave, seated alone in glory, throne in the highest praise. You sent the darkness running out of an empty grave, seated alone in glory, throne on the highest praise. You sent the darkness running out of an empty grave, seated alone in glory, throne on the highest praise. You sent the darkness running out of an empty grave, seated alone in glory, throne on the highest praise. Reign above it all, reign above it all. Over the universe and over every heart, there is no higher name. Jesus, you reign.
Let all.
Let all of heaven and the earth erupt the soul. Sing hallelujah to the everlasting one. There is no higher name. Jesus, you
song. Sing hallelujah to the everlasting one. There is no higher name. Jesus, you reign above it all.
Will you join me in prayer? Dear Lord, you do reign above it all, Father. Lord, whether it's in our homes, our country, our world, Father, you have all of it in your hands, Father, and we trust that that you know the outcome, Lord, and we put everything, all our hope, all our treasures in you, Father. Lord, just ask as we embark on a new year, Father, the 150th year of this church, Lord, we just ask that you continue to bless it, Lord. We just ask that you bless these tithes and offerings that we give this morning, Lord, that you would bless it in a way that only you can bless. All this we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Lord God, I just ask that this time that we're here, Lord, that as Pastor Anthony comes to preach, we would just open up our heart and our mind to you, Lord, to receive the word that you are speaking through him this morning, to let it affect our lives, to transform our lives, Lord, to convict us where we need convicting, encourage us where we need encouragement. Whatever we need, Lord, I pray that your word would move powerfully and we'd be willing to accept it, Lord. We wouldn't fight it if it makes us uncomfortable, but we would just want to be pursuing your truth this morning, Lord. Thank you for this time. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right, you may be seated. Good morning, Cal Island Baptist Church family. During our service, this is the time we have what's called the apologetic moment. And every Sunday, normally speaking, we will have a point in time in our service where we will look at something from Scripture, from science, or from the news, just to bolster your faith a little bit. Before we get into studying God's Word and hearing God's Word, I would like to just give you every Sunday a reason to believe God's Word. One more reason. And this week I have an article to share with you. Stephen, if you'll pull that up. This is from World News Magazine. It says, new research method helps verify event mentioned in the Bible's Old Testament. Specifically, this is from 2 Kings chapter 12, verse 17, where it just briefly mentions that King Aram routed the city of the Philistines. And for years, there were skeptics that would say that there's no evidence of this. And they say this is a reason not to believe the historicity of the Bible. And recently, just in the last month or so, and this isn't just from this magazine, there's a few other articles, if you look this up, that confirms this. They have looked at the magnetic, pole of the bricks that were found at this site, and they uniformly have the same magnetic pole. Now, that's above my pay grade. But the common understanding at this dig site was that these bricks had fallen down and come into ruin through a gradual amount of time. However, if that had been the case, then they would have had different magnetic poling, okay? But what they've discovered is that they were all burned or fired at the same time, and so all the pole of the different bricks were in the same direction, so it took place at the same point in time, and this has been confirmed, 2 Kings chapter 12 and verse 17. Incidentally, this also, in the article, it goes on to talk about how this pushes back the date of the firing of bricks and the technology of firing bricks. It pushes it back much farther than what was once thought. Of course, the scripture speaks about the firing of bricks at the Tower of Babel. In this article, it speaks about how this pushes it back scientifically much closer, if not to the actual time of what the scripture would say was the Tower of Babel. So there's really two here for one. You have the confirmation of 2 Kings chapter 12 and verse 17 that the city of Gath was routed by King Aram. And then also, they've discovered through this study that the science or the technology of firing bricks to make them stronger is pushed back now, and many say consistent with the Tower of Babel. All right, that's your apologetic moment. If you have your Bibles today, we will be in James chapter 4. We'll be reading verse 13 through 15. In seminary, I was told, you must always preach exposition, expositorily. So you want to go through the Bible, a book of the Bible, every verse, one verse at a time, going through and not skipping anything. And my professor said, well, once a year, preach a topical sermon and then come back and repent. And so I will do that. But I preached a topical sermon last Sunday, but guess what? That was not this year. So that was last year. So I get another one and I'm using it. I get three times a year to disagree with Terry. I haven't used any of those yet. And I get to preach it topically once a year, outside of Christmas and Easter, of course. And this is, I guess I'm going to go ahead and use it up. Let's go ahead and read God's Word. If you would, please stand. We'll be in James chapter 4. We'll read verse 13. And where's Jacob? Can you do me a favor? I'm sorry. On my desk is some brown paper. It's got all my notes. I'm sorry. If you don't find it or whatever, that's okay. I'll go without them. But let's go ahead and read God's Word, beginning in verse 13. It says, come now, you who say today or tomorrow, let's go into this city and spend a year there. Trade and make a profit. Verse 14. Whereas you do not know what your life will be like tomorrow, for what is your life? For you are a vapor that appears for a little time and then vanishes away. For you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we will both live and do this or that. Father God, I ask you bless this time and this message in Jesus' holy name. Amen. You may be seated. You can see the picture in front of you. Does anyone know who this is? If you do, go ahead and call it out. Somebody, what'd you say? It's not Up, but Up is inspired by this person. His name is Larry Walters. Larry Walters, since the age of, he says, 13, remembered wanting to be a pilot. I have that same desire. One day Randy's going to teach me to fly. I just know it. But he wanted to be a pilot. And, of course, he didn't go to pilot school. He became a truck driver instead. And his whole life he would think about, how am I going to get up in the air? How am I going to fly? And he kept putting it off. He did have an idea, because one time he was in a military surplus with his father, and he saw a bunch of weather balloons. And he thought, if I could just put helium in enough of those balloons, that will get me up in the air, and then I can consider that flight. And he said, my whole life I just kept putting it off, until one day I decided I couldn't put it off anymore because I didn't know if I would have tomorrow. And so he took about 45 of these military weather balloons. This is not a fake story. This is absolutely true. How many have already heard of this? I'm not making this up at all. In San Pedro, California, I believe. And he attached them to a lawn chair. Yeah, I know this guy's plans, it doesn't sound like it's been consulted by engineers or anything, but he attaches 45, that's it, man. He attaches 45 weather balloons to a lawn chair on top of a Jeep. And he has them tied down with ropes. Thank you so much. Has them tied down with ropes, and he packed in his lawn chair a pellet gun, sandwiches, and beer. That doesn't sound like he's really thinking this through too much. I mean, beer up in the air with balloons and whatever. And he had his friends there, and he had them contact air traffic control. He also had a walkie-talkie, if you will. And before he knew it, beyond what he had planned, his friends were supposed to release him at a certain point in time, and so he would go up evenly, and they didn't. They messed up, and next thing you know, he said, I blinked, and I was, what's that? Oh, is it not working? I thought it was, is it me? Oh, okay.
All right. And the Lord said, let there be light. Is that better? All right. Before he knew it, he was 16,000 feet in the air. 16,000 feet in the air. And he was spotted by a Southwest airline pilot who radioed air traffic control and said, there's a man flying in a lawn chair. You often think about things that you would never form a sentence and actually say. I'm sure that pilot never thought he would have to tell air traffic control that there was a man flying 16,000 feet in a lawn chair. He was afraid he would not have the next day, is what he said when he was asked later. Why now? Larry Walters said, I didn't know if I would have tomorrow. Something I thought about, and I put off and put off, and finally, I made it happen. It's funny, because once he got down, he was arrested for violating airspace. But he did, as it goes on, he got an endorsement from Timex Watches. I'm not sure why. He appeared on the Johnny Carson show, and he went around the country giving motivational speeches. So here's this guy. One day he's unknown, and he does what was laid on his heart from the time of a child. And next thing you know, he's a star. He didn't know if he had tomorrow. Today's message, I want to share with you something I've preached once before on a New Year's Sunday. But it's so important. I love this passage of Scripture. I love how it's so blunt and it's so clear. And the question I'm asking myself today, and I'm asking you, what we need to ask at the beginning of every year is, how can we make a difference for the kingdom of God? How can we make a difference for the kingdom of God? And the first part of that, if not the main part, is to realize that we do not have tomorrow. James tells us this in such a blunt way. He says, come now, you who say, today or tomorrow, let's go into the city, spend a year there, trade, and make a profit. There's so much that is included in this verse, so much presumption. Come now, let's go to this location. We will go here. We will not go there. We will go here. We will go to the city. I have learned that, not the hard way, but I guess just the only way, that it you need to watch out what you're going to, what you tell God you're going to do or where you're going to spend your time. I've said this over and over again. I remember growing up, I would hear these pastor preachers, my preachers, say the same story over and over again. And as a guy sitting out there, I'd be like, man, he's already said that. Well, now I know why he did. Because it's so real and it's so relevant. Don't tell God where you're going to spend your time. Because I publicly said at my graduation party, a few times preaching in Burleson Bible Church, I told everybody, I will go anywhere in Texas or touching Texas, but I will not go to Houston. And I spent 3 years in Houston. Everybody needs to spend a little time in Houston. Am I right? You got to spend some time there to pay your dues. I'm just kidding. Houston's a great place. I will not go to Houston. I'll go anywhere in Texas or touching Texas. I'll even leave the country and go to Oklahoma. But I'm not going to Houston. The only place that offered me a job was a good church, and I still love the people there in Houston, Texas. And I've said this before, and I need to mention it again, because I'm not the only one that was presuming upon telling God where I would spend my time. My wife, as perfect as she is at times, not always, she also told God what was up, or tried to, because is John Smith here? Yeah, again, you can blame it all on him. When he called me, and I told my wife, hey, I spoke to this guy, John Smith, which at first sounds like I'm making it up, you know. No offense. No, John Smith? Sure. My wife said, I will never go to the coast. I'll never go to the coast. I said, not to Houston. She said, I'll never go to the coast. She did say, I will go meet them. We can go meet them. I'm not going to Corpus Christi. But we can go down there and talk to him. And the whole time we were in arguing, and asked my kids. She was not happy with me. I said, let's just go talk to him. Now here we are. It'll be 7 years in June. 7 years. I can't believe 7 years. My entire ministry. Well, not my entire ministry, because my ministry began when I began serving as a part-time youth pastor, which in case, by the way, there is, and I know this is true, but there is no part-time children's ministry. I know that Ruth knows that, and Victoria, and we all know that there's no part-time ministry, but nonetheless, I guess you quote-unquote say my entire full-time ministry in my life has been spent in places I said publicly, or my wife said publicly, we would never go to. Everything I've ever done in full-time ministry has been spent in a location that I said I would not be, or my wife did. You don't know where you will be next year. You don't know where you may spend some time. You may plan on something, but to presume upon it, to tell God what you're going to do before you consult or even begin to seek His will is presumption. So we do not need to presume upon where we will go spend our time. Come now, it says, today or tomorrow, we will go here. The second thing we need to watch out telling God is what we will do when we get to where we say we will not go. I don't mean to use my wife as an illustration, but it's been two times in her life. She said, I'm not doing anything with children. I don't work well with children. And she does a great job with the children's ministry. She's done the Jesus Fix It program and other things. I'm not bragging on her. I'm just saying she is getting in the habit. She also said, I'll never work with the youth. Youth don't get along. I don't get along with youth. Don't tell God what you will do when you get to where you say you will not be going. God's in the business of using the wrong people for the right jobs. King David grew in stature. He became more kingly. But he didn't start out that way. You would never have chosen King David. So what I'm trying to say is, God doesn't necessarily reject people who look right for the job, but he rejects everyone who thinks they're right for the job, whether they look it or not. because he doesn't care about the outside. He can work that however he needs to. He cares about the person who's humble, who says, whatever God has in my life, well, however God wants to use me. Now, I have some desires, and we all have desires in our hearts. We have ways in which God has created us that shape certain things, and that's okay. But James is warning about people who say, I'm doing this in this place. And he says, don't be foolish like that. Don't tell God where you will be and what you will do while you're there. We cannot presume upon tomorrow. And that's the first part of this verse. There are so many stories in the history of our country in America where the day before something takes place, something drastic, something epic-making, something life-changing and world-changing, everything seemed like it was not going to happen that way. April, I think 16th, 1865. Oh, I got my notes again. 1865. There was nothing but exuberant celebration in the city of Washington, D.C., this horrible war that had ripped the nation in two was finally over. A nation which even those that may have voted for the president said he was nothing but a tall ape. Even the ones that voted for him didn't like him, seemed to now come around to what he had as a vision for America. And it even seemed those who were against him were softening on the resistance to him now that the war was over. And there would be no more bloodshed. And we would be a nation again, united. And in fact, it's been said that's the point in which the United States became the United States, finally. Peace could be had. Until the bullet sunk its way into his brain. The day before the celebration was to take place. No one expected such a thing. A little bit further from that, I was reading a story about a naval officer and his wife. He was a young naval officer. He just got married, and the assignment given to him and his new bride was to spend, he would begin serving, and he got to spend Christmas in Hawaii. I know that we're so grateful for the service of our veterans, men and women, and I oftentimes, and more than likely than not, it's not in their wives and their families. They don't get assigned to Hawaii. Imagine that, though. You're going to go begin serving in Hawaii. And as they got there, they had their quarters or wherever they were living, and they got to decorate it and deck it in the holidays and the way you do with the trees and the lights and everything. And it seemed as though life could get no better than it was at that moment for this naval officer. December 6th, they went to bed and were awakened by the sound of rumbling, an earthquake shattering. Noises and the sensation of the world moving underneath your feet. Don't presume upon tomorrow. To bring it a little bit closer to home, of course, there's September 11th. I got married September 8th. We flew to Cabo San Lucas and spent the day September 9th, September 10th. I thought I had figured it all out. I had got my honeymoon paid for by Broken Bow Records. You can look them up. They've got some famous artists now. And I had played with the band for a certain amount of time. And while I was playing with the band, I said, hey, label, I'm getting married. And you got to give me a wedding present. And so they said, okay, we will pay for your honeymoon. So they bought me plane tickets and got me a week in Cabo San Lucas. And says, okay, good, now I got the honeymoon. I can just quit. I already got them to pay for it. I won't need anything else from them. I won't need them to extend my stay there for any reason. September 11th, I turned on CNN. I still remember it like it was yesterday. And I remember seeing a plane fly into the Twin Towers and thinking it was a movie trailer, quickly realizing that wasn't the case. I called Jim Yerger, Broken Bow Records. This was not very nice. Jim Yerger was a good dude, but I said, Jim, This was a few hours after all this when we found out everything. I said, Jim, I'm in Cabo. They're telling us we have to leave, but flights aren't coming into America. They're not going to let us stay. Can you get me an extra week here? He said, you already quit. I was presuming upon lots of things. I certainly didn't think that would happen. I would go to Cabo. I would go to this place. I would do this while I was there. I would come home, and the events of the world changed. Do not presume upon tomorrow. Do not tell God where you will be, and do not tell God what you will do while you are there. The world is full of stories of things changing in such a way we have no control over. It isn't to do with anything that's our fault or anything we can have done something differently to cause. It just happens, fair or not. Do not presume upon today. Do not presume upon tomorrow. Do not presume is the message. Do not presume. Jesus makes some statements in the New Testament to people who presume or continue to put things off that it sounds sort of harsh, to be honest with you. There's a story of a man who was presuming that he would have the next day, that he would do these things, that he would make a profit. In Luke 12 and chapter 20, this story, a parable of a man who could just admired his wealth. He enjoyed storing it up in storage bins, and he would look at it, and he said, this is what I'm going to do with my wealth. I'm going to continue to hoard it. I'm going to continue to keep it. I'm going to continue to watch it grow and grow and grow. I'm a smart man. I'm successful. I'm wealthy. I'm young enough to think I have tomorrow. And in the parable, God tells the man, you fool, tonight, this very night, your soul will be required of you. None of us can presume upon tomorrow. Do not presume. My second year here, I won't mention their names, but I did five funerals in 6 months. I don't think maybe two of them were over the age of 35. As you get older, I've noticed as a pastor, I guess it just is the laws of mathematics. The funerals seem to get a little younger, and that's sad. Do not presume upon tomorrow. I don't care how healthy you may think that you are. Of course, many people perish in ways that has nothing to do with their health. This young man that was, I don't know his name, and I don't pretend to state it, but just hearing of the young man in Orange Grove recently that was killed in this car accident. I just can't imagine. Don't presume. You can control, think you can control everything in your life, and it doesn't, maybe even if you do everything perfectly, this world is not intended to go on forever. And one day your life will end. I think about this as a church collectively. We're so grateful to be here. Almost. We're not there yet. We're close to being 150. We're not there yet. But it is comforting to consider the fact that for 150 years, God has kept this church going. It is very comforting, and I'm very grateful for it. You're going to hear a lot about it. Let me just say this before I forget. Our celebration will be October 13th, unless some of the politicians that I'm trying to get to come celebrate with us can't make it October 13th. We may move it to October 6th, is it? We may move it some, but October 13th, if you don't have it on your calendar, please put it down on your calendar, and Lord willing, it'll be October 13th, and tell five people about it, and bring them, because 25 years ago, Miss Gaetha, I believe it was Miss Gaetha, in the newspaper said, we're expecting 300 people to be there at our celebration, and I want to beat them back 25 years ago. I want us to have at least 301. I'm serious. I'm not presuming upon it. I'm praying for it. I'm planning for it. Asking God's direction and making that happen. But October 13th, Lord willing, I'd like to see us have 301 people here. That said, we do have a wonderful past. But I have learned specifically that not only can we not presume upon the future, in some ways we can't even presume upon maintaining the past. What do I mean by that? My wife and I had all of our kids' artwork, is what you might call it. All the turkeys, you know, the kids make. They put their hand down and they draw the turkeys at Thanksgiving time. And all the, those are the Tom turkeys, but all the Christmas artwork and all the pictures that we, back before everyone had a camera in their pocket, we still had some pictures, you know, that were printed out. And it was burned up. All the past, in many ways, proving, this may sound funny, my existence, it was gone. And then I thought to myself over the course of time once since that happened, well, that's terrible. I wish that wouldn't happen. We still had some of our wedding photos. They're burned around the edges. But you know what? This is the digital age. And everything's stored digitally anyways. And I got basically all the memories of my children and things and different events that I posted on Facebook. It's saved right there. No problem. It's digital. And what the fire didn't take, Facebook did about 6 months ago. I got on my account and it was gone. Somebody from Australia now is me. Gone. So in some ways, you certainly can't presume upon the future, but you almost in some ways, and I know it's not exactly one for one, but you can't presume upon the past. What I think I'm trying to say is God is timeless and we are not. And we can't presume upon anything. Not today, not tomorrow, not yesterday. This very night, your soul may be required of you. I have to share one more story. Kate was a girl that I was in my youth group. I've mentioned this before. And she was the cream of the crop, if you can say that, of youth. That's wrong. I'm not trying to say I categorized them or judged them or said he's good, she's good. I guess I did a little bit. Do you do that? No, you don't do that. But my youth group began to grow when she arrived. And I'm not giving her credit for it. It was God using her for about a year. And then one Sunday afternoon, I got a call. And I was told to come to the children's hospital. And Kate, who had some pain in her back, I don't want to scare anybody, she died about a year and a half later. And I would have never thought that would have taken place. I presumed upon wonderful things happening in the youth group and God working through her life. And he did. And one thing she told me before she died, and I cried. I just cried and cried and cried. I thought I'd never get over this. She said, I don't want to be forgotten. That was her only concern. That and she was concerned that her mom, she wouldn't give her mom grandchildren. But she said, I don't want to be forgotten. And you know what? At the time, I said, you won't be, Kate. And the most forgetful, I didn't think how uncomforting that statement was coming from the most forgetful person in the world. And I realized that what she had done for God's kingdom wasn't dependent upon me remembering to mention it. Hebrews 6:10 says, God is not stupid and unjust like Anthony Aquino is. He will not forget. He will not forget. He won't forget what you have done for his people and his gospel. Nothing you do for God's kingdom is a waste of time, and it will not be forgotten. He will remember it. It's timeless. You can presume upon that. You can trust in that. Nothing you do. Jesus says in Matthew 19 and 29, in fact, he says that nothing you give up for me and my kingdom, you will not receive back in this life, whatever that means, 100-fold, and in the world to come. Nothing you do, nothing you give up will be forgotten and will not be rewarded. For God is not unjust. He will remember. You will not be forgotten. Anything done for the kingdom of God will not be forgotten. God does not have a bad memory. He does have selective memory because he does forget the sins that he's forgiven us of. But the things we have done for him, he will not forget. And I'm wrapping this up. I've kind of gotten off my notes, but that's okay. We don't need to presume about anything. Not tomorrow. We don't need to presume that where we'll be. We don't need to presume about what we're going to do when we get there. Well, what do we need to do, Pastor? What do we need to do? Well, we need to first, and this sounds fundamental, but we need to first pray. We need to acknowledge God, ask God to direct our paths. John Wooden, the great basketball, UCLA basketball coach, who was called the Wizard of the Court, he's won more basketball games and championships. It's crazy. Anyone ever heard of John Wooden? Anyone? Okay. If you were playing ball when he was coaching, that's where you wanted to go as a player. And I was reading the account of one of his players, and he says, the first day of practice, I got there, and I was so excited. I had a scholarship. John Wooden had recruited me, and I was ready to learn everything he had to teach about the game of basketball, and I was ready to soak it all up. And the first day, we were all there, and he stands up. He says, I'm going to teach you today one lesson, and it's how to put on your socks. He said, the importance of wearing your socks correctly cannot be overstated. If you put them on with wrinkles, you'll develop blisters. And you may even subconsciously begin to try to overcorrect for the blisters. So you'll be stepping and running in a way that may cause you to have an ankle sprain. And that ankle sprain will take you out of the games and the season. Possibly it could ruin your entire college basketball career. So your first lesson is how to put on your socks. And then they went home. Sometimes we need a reminder of the fundamentals. And if we're not to presume, one thing we are to do is to pray before anything in our lives. Acknowledge God in all his ways, and he will direct your paths. Pray. We are to pray. And then finally, we are called not to stay put. Once we've prayed, once we've asked God to open up doors, to show us how we can begin to serve his kingdom through his church, it's time to not stay put. It's time to live purposefully. It's time to get going. Larry Walters, this man who, from obscurity, became famous at least for a while, he did say, I was afraid I wouldn't have tomorrow, and I wanted to accomplish what I had dreamed about from childhood. But he also said this. They said, why did you do it today? Why now? Why? He said, I got tired of just sitting there. Some of us need to get tired or pray that God causes us to be tired of just sitting there. One day I'll do this. When I have this amount of money in the bank, when my kids are this age, or when things are such that my schedule works itself out, one day I'll do this, one day I'll do that, one day I'll begin serving here, one day I'll go serve in ministry where it's uncomfortable, one day I'll help the youth, one day I'll serve and teach children, one day I'll attend the men's or women's Bible study. One day I may get up and use gifts in ways that I've always been afraid to do, but I know God's gifted me in a certain way. Maybe one day I'll sing in front of the church. One day I'll share Christ with someone at work. One day I'll do it when the time's right, when I feel like it's right. God's message is acknowledge him and then get tired of just sitting. Get up. Get going. I'll make you fishers of men. Let's go. Come on. You don't know if you're going to have tomorrow. You don't know what tomorrow will bring. It's time to get going. Do not presume. Pray, and then no longer stay put. If you're here this morning, you've never trusted in Jesus Christ, there's a word for you consistent with all this in Hebrews chapter 3 and verse 15. It says, today if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. Did you know hearing God's voice, being convicted about anything, feeling bad about anything? If you feel bad when you sin in any sort of way or do anybody any sort of wrong, that's God's voice, and that's grace. As Christians, we can also fall into this trap. If today you hear his voice, do not harden your heart, because even the slightest desire to do anything for God's kingdom is his grace. Be obedient to it. If you've never trusted in Jesus Christ, be obedient to that. Believe in him. Trust in him. Make it publicly known. Get baptized. Join a church. It's very simple. The fundamentals are not difficult. Do not presume. Pray. And then do not stay put. I wanted to share, we don't know what we have tomorrow. We don't. No one knows the future. I don't care who you talk to or what you may consult. There's but one who knows the future. And I thought about a quote I read from William Shakespeare's Macbeth. And I think I've remembered it correctly. In Macbeth, he says, "Show me the one who can look at the seeds of time and tell me which will be planted and which will grow and prosper, and let him speak to me." Okay? Well, obviously no one can, but there is one who can. Did you realize God never is up in heaven and he never says, "Did you just see that?" That never happens to him. How does that make sense to us? I'm not exactly sure, and neither are you. But nothing takes him by surprise. We can trust him with our future. We can trust him with our past. Do not presume. Pray and acknowledge him, and do not stay put. Would you bow your heads with me? Father God, I pray for those in this church as we begin to celebrate a past. May it not be an excuse to not press on, Lord. May our celebration of what you've accomplished in 150 years here at Cal Allen Baptist Church not be an excuse to not press on and trust you for the next 150 years. There are no laurels to rest upon in this life. Lord, that will be a constant theme in the year 2024 is our celebration, but I pray it never become an excuse to not press on. In our own lives, Lord, I pray that we never presume upon today, tomorrow, or even the past. We trust you with all the times in our lives, past, present, and future. May we continue, Lord, to pray, acknowledge you in everything that we do, everything we begin to plan and celebrate here at this church or even our own lives, acknowledge you. And you will direct our paths. You've promised that. And Father, what your scripture says and is consistent all throughout your Bible is you never ever have told anyone for any extended period of time in someone's life. Yeah, there are times where in your word you do say, "Wait patiently," but those are clear and directed to individuals. You never say, "I want you to spend a lifetime of just staying put." May we get tired of sitting there, starting with me. Like Larry Walters, let go, Lord, and see all that you may have for us. From 10,000, 30,000 feet and below, Father, from the perspective, eternal perspective that you have, that is my prayer. If there's anyone here that's never trusted in Jesus Christ, I pray today they don't stay put. If there's anyone here that your Holy Spirit has been working in their hearts, Lord, to covenant with Cal Allen Baptist Church, I pray that they don't stay put. That's my prayer for this church, for me individually, specifically me, starting with me. In 2024 and beyond. And I thank you, Lord. I ask all this in Jesus' holy, powerful, precious name. Amen.
You are the source of life that can't be left behind. No one else will do. I will take hold of you, 'cause I need you, Jesus, to come to my rescue. Where else can I go? There's no other name by which I am saved. You capture.
trust in you. 'Cause I need you, Jesus, to come to my rescue. Where else can I go? There's no other name by which I am saved. Won't you capture me with grace? I will follow you. I will follow you. This world has nothing for me. I will follow. This world has nothing for me. I will follow you. This world has nothing for me. I will follow you. This world has nothing for me. 'Cause I need you, Jesus, to come to my rescue.
Church. Important reminder, this week we will resume our normal Wednesday night activities. That starts off with dinner in the CLC at 5:30, followed by Bible study groups at 6 o'clock. We'll have Bible studies for the men, women, youth group, children, and we have the nursery available. Also, before you leave, please stop by the Christmas card cubby and check on any leftover cards that you may still have. Let's empty that out by today. I have an announcement about announcements. If you have an announcement that you'd like to make for any ministry that you're involved in, please contact the church office so we can send you an information form to fill out. That form will need to be completed and returned no later than the Monday before you want that announcement to be made. Final announcement. Cal Allen Baptist Church will be doing a new church directory in honor of our 150th anniversary year. We want everyone to be in it, whether you're a member of CBC or just a regular attender. Families that participate will receive a free 8x10 photo and a directory. You can sign up to have your picture taken by scanning the QR code in your bulletin, by visiting with Debbie Van Zandt or Terry Jones in the foyer after church, or by calling Terry Jones at the office.
That covered a lot of what I was going to say. I want to add to that that we are beginning a brand new women's Bible study this Wednesday, and we're going to be going through the book of Esther. So we would invite all women to come join us. You won't be coming in the middle of something and not know what's going on. It's a good time and a good way to start the new year fresh with us. I also wanted to thank the Roseburg family for the beautiful flowers that you donated in honor of Gary. We love you, Judy. Thank you for that. And let's see, Disciple Now weekend will be Friday the 12th through Saturday the 13th. Jacob will have more details about that. Save the date for the game day on Sunday, February 11th. Activities will begin at 3 with flag football, and then at 5:30 we'll be showing the game in the CLC, and you can come and join for snacks and games and lots of fun other things. Have a good week, everyone.
I just very quickly have, our children's department is in need of a Wednesday night teacher for our kinder through second grade group. So if you feel led to teach or maybe have a little bit of questions, might be interested, please see me. We would love to have you. Also, just real quickly, right after service next Sunday, we will be having a quick church conference. Take about 5 minutes of your time, but we need all of you church members to please plan to stay behind for that right after service next week. That's all that I have.
I will say this is a good year. It's a good year.
If you'd stand, receive this benediction, then we'll be dismissed. May God the Father be so deep-seated in your heart that whatever tomorrow brings, you always trust in his faithfulness, in his guidance, and his purpose he has given you. For God will plant you wherever he sees fit. And if you find that you are a tropical plant planted in an arid desert, have faith that God has his reasons, and God alone has the power to nurture you and make you bloom, even in the most unlikely place. Don't presume tomorrow, but follow God in whatever path he lays before you. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen.
I can only imagine when that day comes.